Well, I can only say that occasions such as this put me and put Roena and Hillary's, we're unaccustomed to doing anything except being servants. Roena has the most profound servant heart of anybody I've ever known. And since I was 8 years old, there was nothing that I wanted to do besides be a physician. That's why at a more mature age than that, I find it difficult to quit because I love what I do. But part of it has been being here today and for the last 2 years once this decision was made and what to do with it. And none of this ever, if you stop and think about it, you don't own anything. You may think you do, but you don't. And it just so happens that we had the opportunity to think about what to do with this collection, which was never required to be anything other than just something we enjoyed doing. But finally, once it was there and once it seemed like a reasonably good one, then it was time to decide what to do with it. And things gelled perfectly. And we could not be happier than we are that it's right here. I would prefer that you were in my den at home that I'd have the opportunity to pull a book off the shelf and talk to you about it. And there's still a bunch more that most likely will end up here. but that have been just part of our lives. And so that means part of us is still here. And to have been a student here, and I'll mention that in a minute or two. But for these 2 days, we're talking about the immutable, one of the immutable foundational pillars of Western civilization. And so that last lecture was so well explained how a small committee of Englishmen that were his instruments 4 centuries ago communicated his gospel to future generations. That's exactly what this is all about. I never suspected that we would be a part of that small group of people that would do something that we were involved in that would be here and with the not only a plan but activity going on, explaining and encouraging others. And these are things that will attract not everybody, but attract a few people. And when it does, they too may be as surprised and as amazed at the true story of what this is all about, what bringing the Bible to us has been, that it will encourage others to be not only to understand the Word and its meaning to them and to us, but it will also encourage them to utilize the collection for whatever reason. It was 62 years ago that I was 20 years old, a senior at Hardin-Simmons, waiting to hear if I'd been accepted to medical school. And at that particular time, it was 3 years after the war had been over, and all the guys that had come back that didn't want to be physicians had gone to college and had either completed enough of their degree or all of them already graduated. So what that really meant is that, for instance, at Southwestern Medical School, which is where I was applying, there were 2,000 people applying that year for 100 spaces. Even now, when I think about that, the opportunity that I've had doing what I wanted to do for all those years is truly amazing. Once that occurred, I thought, everything I wanted to accomplish has been accomplished. But I had no way, I had no money to go to college. I had some teachers at Abilene High School that knew some folks out here at Hardin-Simmons, and they said, we're going to see what we can do. And I still have the letter that Dr. Collins wrote me and asked me to come to his office to talk about the possibilities. And from that letter and from that appointment, which I remember as if it were yesterday, I was given the opportunity to work in the chemistry lab. And work I did. It was a lot of time and a lot of effort and all that sort of thing. But it gave me that opportunity to graduate from this wonderful university. And then I was able then to go to medical school. Well, there was still time to worry about where the money was coming from. Obviously, didn't mind working. I worked at Abilene at Wilson's Drugstore, at Lauder North Funeral Home, at a grass cutting service. I sold corn cob, toads, anything that I could do. And that's why they're not, you can't find any. I paid the kids a nickel to get them for me, and we sold them for a quarter. Then to go to medical school, my cousin wrote me a letter saying that he wanted me to come to Weatherford. He's a businessman down there, come to Weatherford, and he would talk to me about what to do. So I went down there, and he said, well, how much do you need? Well, I told him, and believe it or not, to go to medical school, I only had to borrow $3,000. Well, that was $300,000 to me, but nevertheless, it was there. And the amazing thing is that 30 years later, he sent me that letter back. He had saved it and sent it back to me because I explained to him what I thought my future might potentially be. Well, I finally interned at Parkland, the Air Force, Salina, Kansas, and with the Strategic Air Command, and a wonderful time there. And fortunately, I've never been anywhere, done anything that I haven't been happy doing, because I'm convinced that today is today and tomorrow is tomorrow. I just make the best of it. It doesn't matter, so therefore. But at any rate, I had met Lee Thames here at Hardin-Simmons, and we were married at the end of my sophomore year at medical school. Glenn, our son, was is also a Hardin-Simmons graduate. I interned at Parkland, and then I came back for my residency in anesthesia. Lisa died the day I was 40 years old. I thought my world had ended. But now Roena and I have been married for now soon to be 41 years. I tell a lot of people that she's never had a fur coat, but she's held a lot of wonderful books in her lap and looked at them. Oh, that's right. And when the farm was there, and I put a sign out on the pond at the farm, Roena's fur coat. In 1960, we were invited to go down to go to the First Baptist Church in Dallas, and I said, I don't want to go to the First Baptist Church. I used to church about the size of the South Side was here in Abilene, and I just was not interested in that. Well, we eventually went, and the teacher there was Charles Ryer. 10 years, at one time at a Christmas party, he brought a little book over and he just began to talk about it. This was a 1630 King James Bible, and when you turn to Exodus 20, it says, "Thou shalt commit adultery." Well, the story, as the story goes, and most of you heard it before, but still a good one. They were able to buy off one of the typesetters in Robert Parker's printing shop, who held the permission to print the King James Bible. And of course, when that was published, it disgraced the marker to have allowed something like that to happen. They burned all of as many of the books as they could, and there's that's one of the ones that there are only about 20 still in existence. At any rate, I was just blown away with that story, and I asked him, I said, you know, this is an amazing story. This is inviting. So surely somebody written a book about the history of the English Bible. He said, oh, yes, this, I'll bring you one. So the next day or two, he brought me one, and it was F.A. Bruce's The History of the English Bible. And I began to read that, and the story unfolded, the likes of which I'd never heard. I knew nothing about it. And I could not believe what I saw. There are people giving their lives just for the interpretation of scriptures, the printing of Bibles, and all that bit. So I says, I just read with everything I could get my hands on. And so I needed a birthday gift. And I just called Charles, and I said, says, get me a 1611 King James Bible, and I need it for a birthday. He just laughed, and he said, you're just crazy. He says, you don't have any idea what you're asking for. And I said, well, he said, in the first place, you couldn't afford it. The second place, I have no idea where you'd find one. And says, forget that. And I said, well, I need something. And so anyway, he found me a pilgrim Bible that was falling apart, for which he paid $50, and I gave him $50 and used that. It was the first old book that we had ever seen or ever owned. And it began months and the years went by, it became a passion to everywhere we'd go, we'd haul to bookstores, everywhere we'd I'd spend time reading catalogs, send off the catalogs, and going to every library that I could find. And speaking of going to libraries is the best place in the world to go to meet folks who really know what they're doing and who really care. And I could write a tome on nothing but librarians I met, fascinating encounters with a world that is on a shelf somewhere that no one's looked at in 50 years, and yet there's a wonderful story in there. And there's no end of what the opportunities that I've had now over all these years that have enhance my knowledge and also plagiarize a few good stories that needed to be told. Well, even today we still can't pass a bookstore without going in to see them. And I'm always looking for, I collected a few little humor books, and one of them I really like is Pig's Pigs. And another one I'm always looking for, because there are 23 editions of it, and it's Will Rogers' very last book, called Ether and Me, in which he's trying to sell enough copies of the book to pay the exorbitant doctor bills that he had when he got sick in Waxahachie and made a beeline for California to have his gallbladder out, because he knew good and well he didn't want his gallbladder out in Waxahachie. The number of book dealers around the world that I've had contact with and who write these wonderful catalogs and enhance my knowledge of the book world are just really amazing. And some of them I could spend hours talking about it. But from Alaska to Peru to Greece to every place we've been, there have been times and opportunities to meet, not only to meet people that would never ever have met before, but to also to have the opportunities to collect books that we never dreamed of owning, and we never had any intention of doing that. But the amazing thing is, I say amazing, I could choose a better word, but I'm convinced that truly the hand of God was on the pursuit and the pursuit and the acquisition of numbers of these books that we got, and I didn't even know that. But now it's beginning to be unveiled, I'm just grateful that Hardin-Simmons is the recipient of that, and it not only helps us to know that, but I look forward to what in the many years to come, what can take place, and the opportunities that it can give you folks, and even those involved, the opportunity to share that with other people. There was just one story about the King James Bible, and that was the one projected there in the last copy. It's a beautiful copy. But when I got it, the binding was not in good shape. It needed some work, and I knew that I needed to find somebody that would do it. And we'd been to London a few months before, and we'd gone out to see a fellow that had done some of the binding for us, who really is, I'm convinced, has been the world's finest bookbinder. And he binds. He does mainly really quite old and quite unusual books, and does it as if he were a contemporary binder at the time when it's published. But the interesting thing is that his house is the last stop of the subway in London. Clapham Road is where you get off. And we've been there a few times, but when we finally decided that Mr. Middleton was going to be the guy that we wanted to do that binding, I was trying to figure out how I was going to get back to England, and it didn't look like I was going to get there for a few years. And so I had a friend, a political friend, that as I look back on it, you'd want her as a political friend, but you wouldn't want her particularly to be transporting your King James Bible. Well, but she's going to London. And so I said, okay, Peggy, I want you to take this book, and I'm going to give you the exact place to put it. And I said, if you have to get in a cab and go out there, it's going to cost a fortune to do that. I'd rather you ride the subway. So we wrapped it up and put it in a carry bag, and she got on that airplane and left. And when I think about it, I would not do that again. Because she had no idea what she had, you know. And I didn't either. But nevertheless, all worked out well, and things were just fine. You need to be careful if you do come to our house, because sometimes I know better than I don't know any better than keep talking. So Roena is already looking a little like it might be time. But when they asked me to make a few remarks, I thought, well, what could I do that would really be different? And then I decided not to do it, but I'm going to do it anyway, because I'll try to do it in a hurry. But I thought, well, you know, I know of several places where there are other copies of King James Bible in Texas. And so I thought, well, I'm just gonna see if I can catalog those places and go visit them. So I thought about doing that, and I thought, well, what could I entitle that talk? And I said, well, let's first start out by saying a visit with King Jimmy. on Highway 35. And so I think, I just think about going down 35, because since Dallas is right there on it, would it be easy to do that? And then I finally had to expand it to the whole state. But at any rate, we've gone to a number of places and found some interesting things. Austin College, I started up there at the Red River. No, they don't have it. North Texas, no. Texas Women's, no. SMU has 7. You can believe that. But they have had many, many years and some very rich people to make that collection possible. And it's a wonderful collection. And the Pro Throws and Mr. Harrison, who gave them the money to build the Ripple Library, and then they purchased one copy. Charles Ryan has I think, the finest copy I've ever seen anywhere. But interestingly enough, our friends down at Baylor don't have any. And I said, well, do you use the Bible down here? Actually, I left with a very good friendship with the library. and then on to Southwestern and Georgetown, they don't have any, but they have a Gutenberg leaf. And she wanted me to come down and see that. But also at North Texas, they wanted me to come see that. All of us said, we got some wonderful books on costumes, about artists in the Revolutionary War. And I said, well, I'll do that on my next effort to collect. Not right now. Texas, this is a treasure at the Ransom Center at the University of Texas that is beyond belief. If you have interest in history, interest in books, interest in all the collections that they put together there. And they have four copies there. And it's fun to go down there just to see one, but it's like getting in Fort Knox to steal the gold to get in. And then there was absolutely no one that I could talk to. And I had some things that they needed to know. Rice University had no, but they said, we don't answer questions like that over the telephone. Said, you'll have to send us an email. And I said, what's an email? Anyway, I sent them an email, and still no answer. Houston Baptist has a very nice collection down there, and Don Brake and John Hellstrom have their collections there, and that's they're working very well with it. But the four copies that we have here are just, it's an amazing thing that's a possibility. You just can't imagine. I was talking to one guy, a fellow that had written several books about collecting and whatnot, and he said, well, I heard that there were some out there in Abilene, and I said, yeah, I've heard that too. And he said, what would he be doing out there in that little town? And I think I'll go back and call him again and just tell him exactly what's happening in that little town. Midwestern University has a copy, which I felt was unusual, but it turned out that his Prothero put one there too. And Texas Tech has none. But that ends up being about 21 copies in Texas, and which is really pretty amazing. I doubt seriously that there's any other state in the country that even approaches that. And there's a wonderful copy, one that I found out about that I didn't even know about. The most profusely illustrated King James Bible was the one printed in 1770. Over 100 years later, and it's the most profusely illustrated book ever printed. And it is the most beautiful book that you can imagine. Copper plate engravings, and just an amazing book. And there is one copy in the Ransom Center in Austin. Well, In 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine and reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished to all good works.
Well, if you believe that, and I do, unashamedly, then what we're doing, what all of you have done, and what you're trying to do for the future, this is a beginning. And I just, my prayer is that God provided the lamb, He provided the donkey, He provided these Bibles, and I was an instrument in doing that. Roena has been, and consequently, we just look to the future and truly hope and pray that it not only touches the lives of those who want to see something old, but who want to see their own lives changed and made new.